Okay, good morning. So today I'm going to use slides because I have some data to show, but so that usually means I go too fast and cover too much, so it's your job to stop me and ask questions so that the pace is reasonable. And I want to continue talking about bosonic codes and using photons as the primary carrier of the quantum information inside your quantum computer, and the transmons, the things that other people are using as the qubits, we're just going to use as a kind of ancilla controller to allow us to have universal control over the photon states in the resonators. So our controller is this artificial atom, the transmon. Here's a picture. It's about a millimeter long with aluminum superconducting pads evaporated on a sapphire substrate. It's just like a little antenna with two sides connected by a Josen junction, which you've heard is acts like a nonlinear inductor. And so you get a kind of anharmonic oscillator. And if I said to you, I'm going to make an atom with an atomic number 10 to the 12, you might think, oh my God, the spectrum is going to be incredibly complex. But because of the superconductivity gapping out the single particle fermionic excitations, the only low energy mode left is Cooper pairs sloshing back and forth between the two plates of the capacitor through the junction. And it's just an anharmonic oscillator. It has a quantized energy level spectrum. It's simpler than hydrogen. No fine structure, no hyperfine structure. And the quality factor, the transition frequency times T1, is, it's not quite as good as the hydrogen 1s2p, but it's pretty close. So, you know, when we first started, our artificial atoms were embarrassing compared to real atoms, but now they're getting pretty good. And we have this big advantage, which is the enormous transition dipole moment of going from the ground state to the excited state of the charges sloshing back and forth. The zero point uncertainty of the charge is 3 or 4 or 5 Cooper pairs. And so the dipole moment is that zero point uncertainty in the charge times the size. So it's about 10 electron millimeters, which is way bigger than even the Rydberg atom people use, and way, way bigger than, you know, the transition dipole moment of sodium, say. And that enormous dipole moment combined with putting the atom in a cavity whose volume is only an eighth of a cubic wavelength gives tremendously strong coupling to the electromagnetic field and is the secret to doing everything that we do in circuit QED. So I've invented a law of physics. There's no such thing as too much coherence. You know, if you're trying to run a quantum computer and you get the coherence time up to 1 second, someone will come and say, yes, but I want to run my program for 2 seconds because I have a bigger problem to solve. You're always going to need quantum error correction. And there are a number of routes being pursued. One is surface code. And it's beautiful and interesting. It has local stabilizers, weight 4, and geographically, spatially local. But it's very complicated. You've got to read out. You've got to control and read out all these different qubits. And it has, you know, a big parts count. There's a very interesting paper by Leo DiCarlo where they try to do honest simulations to see, you know, how good does T1 and T2 have to be in such a thing, and you know, you might be able to break even with a 49-qubit surface code with fairly long T2 and technological advances that prevent you, allow you to do the stabilizer measurements more accurately and in a more QND manner than can be done now, you might be able to break even at this point. But it's going to be quite challenging, and there's going to be all kinds of wires. So so we're going to talk, so that we, you know, you can describe that as scaling up and then trying to learn how to do error correction. We're going to try to do things in reverse, learn how to do error correction, kind of native error correction right in at the lowest level with bosonic codes, build small modules of holding bosonic codes, and then do remote entanglement, communication, quantum communication between the modules with the very same error correctable codes, and teleported states and gates.
Yep. So why would you say you want to use something to do remotely? Because you say, well, that link is maybe much lower coherence than, you know, something that is on the chip.
Well, yeah, so that's a good question. So it could be on chip if you're doing a 2D sort of architecture. If you're doing 3D, then you have, you know, actual cables connecting the different parts. One advantage of doing things remotely means, you know, half a centimeter away, is really good on-off ratios. So if you entangle things, they have to somehow interact, or you have to use various protocols that bounce photons off each other, and they don't necessarily ever interact. Maybe the photons go through some beam splitter to erase some which path information. You make a measurement whose back action entangles the things. So you can get, there are some advantages, but it's also true, you know, there are disadvantages as well.
Right.
And also, you know, as David Poulin taught us, you know, entanglement over longer distances to make LDPC codes and things, it could be.
You have more flexibility.
Yeah. And then, you know, Rob Sholkov likes to say, well, let's just, you know, we'll build these modules, we'll keep improving them, but we have a kind of API that connects them, and you can, if you make progress in how you design the module, you just replace the modules, you can optimize small bits of the circuit at a time, and it somehow seems possibly more doable. So we're going to replace the physical qubits by photon states stored in high Q cavities, as I've talked about. So this is a picture of a Wigner function of some code words sitting inside this cavity. There's a transmon controller. There's a coplanar waveguide resonator for helping you read out the transmon. And there's a single wire that comes in, and you use frequency multiplexing. You can drive this resonator, you can drive the transmon, you can drive this guy, and you can use this single wire for control and complete state tomography. So that offers a significant advantage. The presence of a nonlinear, if you have just a harmonic oscillator and you drive it with a classical signal generator, all you do is move the vacuum blob around in phase space, you only make coherent states. With an anharmonic oscillator as a controller, you can make, you get universal control. You can do highly quantum non-demolition measurements or state tomography, which is relatively easy in a Hilbert space that's relatively big. The cavities are naturally long-lived, and this protocol has already, or this type of setup has already demonstrated quantum error correction slightly exceeding the break-even point, which I'll define. You'll hear about that particular experiment from Maziar Mirahimi. And a relatively low hardware parts count, a kind of hardware efficiency. And there are a number of different codes you can use inside this box. I mean, this box is just vacuum plus boundary conditions, you know, and you can put different codes in there. And one really cool thing is if you want to use, transmit this state somewhere else for entanglement purposes or communication purposes, the same code that's designed to protect you against photon loss or dephasing or whatever you have when you're stored in the memory will also work when you transmit it through a quantum channel to somewhere else and you fail to capture one of the photons in the receiving end. It's okay because it's already encoded to protect you against those kinds of errors. You don't have to translate it into a new code special for communication. Okay, so the idea then would be to build some kind of array, two or three dimensional array of such structures. And, you know, if you wanted to, you could use this as the first level error correction and build a 2D surface code, if you wanted, as the second level of error correction. And you could, as Barbara mentioned, maybe you could put a GKP state in there, or you could use a binomial code, or even just zero and one photon encoding. Okay, so what are the advantages? Well, you can get 1 to 10 millisecond cavity lifetimes without a huge amount of work. The transmons are good, but this is better. So that's nice. There's a very simple error model that to a very good approximation, there's little dephasing, intrinsic dephasing at least, of the cavity, just photon loss, amplitude damping. And it's in a single mode, so, you know, with a single mode loses a photon, that's just one simple error. If you have a bunch of qubits, you have to figure out which one lost the excitation. So there are more kinds of errors, and I'll go through that more in more detail. You can have the bigger Hilbert space of the cavity replacing multiple two-level qubits without adding more hardware. It's just literally vacuum. And as I mentioned, the same encoded photons can be released from the standing wave in the cavity and be an error-correctable quantum communication code. Okay, so challenges. The cavities are harmonic oscillators, so you don't have universal control of them unless you use the transmon, which was formerly the qubit and is now our controller. And the reason we switched to the cavities was they're better than the transmons, but we can't live without them. So the challenge is the fault tolerant. We need the transmon as a controller, but it's the most faulty part in the system. That's the challenge. Okay. So we have that giant dipole moment of our artificial atom. If we detune the atom from the cavity, they can't directly exchange energy, but only virtually exchange energy. And in second order and perturbation theory, you get this dispersive Hamiltonian that you've now seen a few times. I'm writing it in a little bit different way. Instead of putting sigma z there, I'm going to shift the energy by a constant so that in the ground state, the cavity has some frequency, and then when the transmon goes into the excited state, you get a shift of chi in the frequency of the cavity, okay? But it's the same Hamiltonian up to a constant. And the whole reason we can do all this stuff is that chi can be as big as 3,000 line widths. So it's, you know, even the dipole coupling is so big that even when you detune the atom from the cavity by 20%, from one is at 5 gigahertz, the other is at 6, the second order effects of this large coupling are still gigantic. So this is called the strong dispersive regime, where the dispersive coupling is bigger than all the sources of damping. Okay? So in that strong dispersive regime, you can interpret this term in two ways. One is that the frequency of the cavity, frequency of the qubit, which is the coefficient of sigma z, depends on how many photons are there. There's a quantized light shift. Or you can say the frequency of the cavity depends on the state of the qubit. So we can, this commutes both with photon number and qubit excitation number. So you can make, you can use the cavity to make Q and D measurements of the qubit, and the qubit to make Q and D measurements of the cavity. So here's a long time average of the spectrum of the transmon in the presence of a coherent state in the cavity. So normally when you do spectroscopy, you shine light through a gas and you see, you know, what frequencies get absorbed. This is different. This is called quantum jump spectroscopy. You put a little tone on the qubit at some frequency and you ask what's the probability it jumped into the excited state, which I measure with a separate measurement tone in the cavity. And you can see the spectrum for 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 photons in the cavity. You see the nice Poisson distribution of the coherent state. I told you that these lines were resolved by factors of 1,000. Doesn't look like it here. That's because the graduate students were lazy and power broadened the lines by a factor of 100 to get the experiment over with quickly. But you can count individual photons, and this is one nice way to search for axionic dark matter, for example, to build better than photomultipliers for microwave photons, because it's Q and D. It doesn't eat up the photon when you're detecting it, because the Hamiltonian commutes with photon number. So you can beat down the dark count and raise the quantum efficiency by measuring over and over again improving your signal to noise. Okay, so this is our workhorse Hamiltonian, and the key enabling technology for everything I'm going to tell you about is a controlled parity gate, a controlled phase gate. And all you do is evolve the system under this Hamiltonian for the correct length of time, pi divided by chi, and you get this operator, which is the controlled parity operation. When the transmon, the controller, is in the ground state, this is e to the I zero, which is the identity. And when it's in the excited state, this is e to the minus I pi photon number. So that's the parity operation. It's minus one to the photon number. If you think in phase space, you know, position and momentum, parity takes x to minus x and p to minus p. It reflects you in phase space. So this is a very interesting operation, which either does the identity or performs the parity operation conditioned on the state of the controller, okay? And so this basic concept we borrowed from our friends in Paris, and but we have an extremely large coefficient here, so that's going to give us the power to do all kinds of interesting things. Okay, so this operation, you can see, entangles the state of the ancilla with the photon number parity. And you can use that then by putting the ancilla in an X eigenstate and evolving this. If the parity is even, you stay in the X eigenstate. If the parity is odd, you get a minus sign there and you flip to minus X. And then you can measure X and get the parity, for example. And you can get very high fidelity, very QND measurements that can be repeated hundreds of times without damaging the state you're measuring. Okay, so this is the key enabling technology. We're going to study quantum error correction codes, bosonic codes, where the stabilizer is the parity. And so we'll be able to do this continuous variable quantum error correction. And also, it turns out that being able to measure the parity enables you to measure the Wigner function. So you can do complete state tomography over this one wire in this very high dimensional Hilbert space. So here's the coordinate in phase space, there's the momentum. And I want to know the Wigner function at this point right here. The way I do that is I apply a sharp pulse with a certain phase to the cavity, which displaces the cavity, just gives it a kick in momentum and a displacement in position until that point in phase space is at the origin. And then I measure the average parity at that point. So the parity is not going to be necessarily in an eigenstate of parity, so I have to measure the parity of 100 times or 1,000 times and get the average value. And that displaced parity is the value of the Wigner function at that point. So it's a very simple recipe. Displace, measure the parity, prepare the state again, repeat 100 times, and do that for each point in phase space. So that's just, doesn't matter what the state looks like or how you're encoding things. It's just a simple way to measure the full state tomography. Once you know the Wigner function, that's the same as knowing the density matrix, which is the same as knowing everything. So here's a Wigner function of a Schrodinger cat state. This is a cat state consisting of a coherent state with amplitude plus alpha, superposed coherently with a plus sign with a coherent state with amplitude minus alpha. And so there you see minus alpha, that blob. This is the X coordinate of the oscillator. This is the momentum coordinate of the oscillator. There's the blob corresponding to plus alpha. You see it's a blob because position and momentum don't commute. And so there's vacuum noise. And right there in front of your eyes is resolved vacuum noise. Right? That little blob has area H bar. Then there are very rapid parity oscillations as you displace the state in momentum. And those are interference fringes. They're literally, when you calculate them, they're literally the interference fringes from two Gaussian-shaped slits this distance apart, turned 90 degrees. And those are the whiskers of the cat, and they tell you that it's an even parity cat. This is the same color as those guys. That tells you that's a plus sign. But if it had been a minus sign, the colors would have been reversed. If it had been a mixture, the red and blue fringes would have canceled each other out and you would see no whiskers. So the fact that you see those tells you it's not a mixture, it's truly a coherent superposition, it's a cat. Okay, so let's see. So we have our setup with our high Q storage cavity that's gonna hold our quantum information, our various extra bits to read it. And it turns out that this Hamiltonian combined with drives on the ancilla and drives on the cavity, you can prove that it gives you universal control. Okay? So this by itself, you know, commutes with the qubit state and the cavity state, but when you add the drives, you get control. So you can, you saw that the qubit frequency depended on the state of the cavity, so you can do operations on the qubit conditioned on the state of the cavity. You can displace the cavity conditioned on the state of the qubit because the cavity has different frequencies. So here's an example of that level of control. Here's one of those post cavities that Marina showed you in her talk. There's the transmon controller, there's the CPW resonator for that guy. And so you start out in the photon number zero state. You apply in-phase and quadrature amplitudes to the ancilla with some numerically determined, crazy, uninterpretable wiggles. And you do the same thing to the cavity simultaneously. And then at each, you can stop at each moment of time and measure the photon number distribution of the cavity, and it kind of climbs up and does all kinds of crazy stuff and looking a little bit like a cat or something, and then boom, at the last second, it all lands on n equals 6. And there's the photon number distribution, and there's the Wigner function for n equals 6. It's incredible. So, you know, you just decide what you want to do. You plug this thing into Grape. You figure out some crazy pulses, and it happens. Rob and I always object, you know, tell us why it happens, and the students always say, we don't care, it works. But I think we're slowly giving up. It just works. It's very hard to build, like templates that say, okay, I know roughly how to do it, and I'll start there and let Grape optimize things. It's very non-intuitive. Okay, so that universal control lets us make arbitrary,
In fact, there is a protocol that is understandable, but it's much longer.
Yes.
This one is the one that are not understandable are those that are very efficient.
Right, so there's this Eberle, law, protocol. There are protocols, but when you lay them out and they're understandable, you sacrifice speed. Yeah, it's very interesting. So you can make more or less whatever bosonic code words you want. So let's think about simple ones. So one would be just I can make a qubit out of, you know, zero logical would be the vacuum, and one logical would be the one photon Fock state. Well, that's a great code because it has the least possible number of photons, and the energy decay of an oscillator is proportional to its energy. So this will be the longest lived code. On average, it's using only half a photon, okay? But it doesn't satisfy the Kanil-Laflamme conditions for amplitude damping errors, because if you lose a photon, then you definitely were in that state, not this state, but you're now definitely in that state, and you've lost all the information about the superposition. But this is the longest lived qubit, if you will, in the bosonic world. So this is the target to beat for quantum error correction. If I remember, when you do a quantum error correction, you have many qubits to represent one logical qubit. The error rate always goes up because there are many qubits now having errors, and your Maxwell daemon has to work very fast to use the correctability of the errors to beat that increased error rate and get back to the error rate of the best single physical qubit you have. So this is the analog of the best for continuous variable systems. The best single qubit in your toolbox is this. It has a lifetime just given by the damping rate of the cavity, and you have to beat that. So you're going to use a code that has maybe five photons in it on average. It's going to have errors five times faster, but it's correctable, and you have to break even, you have to beat this. Okay, so I told you about the simplest member of the binomial code family, sometimes called the kitten code. It's a superposition of 0 and 4 photons for one word, 2 photons for the other. They both have average photon number 2. They have error states under amplitude damping that are orthogonal. And it has a code stabilizer, which is photon number parity. These are both eigenstates of parity with eigenvalue plus 1 and parity anti-commutes with photon loss. So when the parity jumps, you know that you lost a photon. So here's the logical block sphere. There's 1. There's the Wigner function of the North Pole. Here's the Wigner function at the South Pole. And the superpositions of those code words at different cardinal points around the equator. And, you know, now, whether you have multiple qubits, physical qubits, making your logical qubit, and you need to do a rotation on the logical block sphere, it's going to be a multi-qubit operation. Here, it's a multi-photon operation. If I want to do a pi pulse, I have to take 0 plus 4 to 2, or 2 to 0 plus 4. Over here, I have to do other combinations. That's not trivial. But by the same numerical grape pulse sequences that I showed you, you with your universal control, you can do these with fidelities in the mid 90s. So here's this is from the Tsinghua group, Lu Yan Sun. We published a paper this year. This is just moving around the block sphere with Clifford operations, checking by randomized benchmarking, and these are the fidelities that you deduce from benchmarking. Yep.
Will you say something? You talked about your workhorse Hamiltonian and that two drives get to all this, but is there extra terms like higher order interaction terms?
Sure. So you know, there's Kerr and various other non-idealities that do get in the way. Well, for the binomial code, it's kind of interesting because you have 0, 2, and 4, and so Kerr ends up looking just like a slight a combination of cavity frequency shift and slight frequency energy difference of the two code words, a slight sigma z term in the Hamiltonian. So then it's okay. That doesn't actually produce any errors. Does that make sense? If you choose your frames correctly, it's not, and the fact that there's only 0, 2, and 4, Kerr doesn't have any deleterious effects on the code words. When you lose a photon, it starts to have an effect, because you don't know when you lost it necessarily. But so that's one advantage of the binomial code. So this is just showing you that you can do rotation, Clifford rotations around the logical block sphere. There's no error correction or anything. And it's just estimating the fidelity with which you can do those rotations. So, yeah. Right, it'll help you with the gates, but then, if something's happening during the idle time, you, maybe you need to, you in principle, you have control, so you could cancel those out also, but it, you know, gets to be work. Okay, so I'll just remind you that we talked about this. So these are eigenstates of parity. If I lose a photon, I get these odd parity states. But there's this very cool fact that they both have mean photon number 2. So there's no distortion. If I have a superposition of 0 logical and 1 logical, and I lose a photon, that common root 2 just goes away in the normalization. And you still have the same quantum information. The coefficients mu and nu are undistorted. They're just multiplying now error states instead of the code states. So your recovery is to take that to that and that to that. And since everybody is orthogonal, there is a unitary that will do that. Again, determined by grape. You do this simple state transfer. And again, the usual story that you can fix a non-unitary error, photon loss, with the unitary by conditioning which unitary you choose on a measurement of the error syndrome. Okay, and then I realized I didn't go into detail on the no jump effect last time, but I told you that if you don't see the parity jump, there's still an effect. Namely, you have to revise downward the amplitude of the high photon numbers in your state because of this. This state is actually invariant because it's an eigenstate of number. This state is not. The amplitude of this is going to go down, and the amplitude of that is going to go up under no jump evolution. And that's equivalent to lowest order in time to mixing in. You can make the amplitude of 4 go down if you mix in a little 0 minus 4, which is the other state in the even parity space. But to lowest order in time, you can show that non-unitary decay can be repaired by unitary rotation that slightly rotates you between those two even parity states and takes away that amplitude to first order in time. So this is again an approximate, the Kneale-Laflamme conditions are only satisfied to lowest order in dt, so it's approximate quantum error correction. But if you can do it very well, you change the error probability from kappa dt to kappa dt squared. So, and if you make dt small enough, you get a big gain. Okay? So I briefly alluded to that, but here's the specifics. Okay, so here is Lu Yan's experiment. And he didn't, you know, there were some constraints on the speed, the way his FPGAs were programmed to do real-time feedback. And so it's not completely optimal how this was done. But basically, you prepare some superposition somewhere on the logical block sphere, and then you measure the parity, and you decide, oh, there was a jump. In which case, I do my unitary state transfer back into the code space, or no jump, and instead of fixing that small no jump error, we're going to do nothing the first time. If there's a jump, you have to fix the error right away because the code can't tolerate 2 losses. If there's no jump and you're rotating a little bit into that 0 minus 4 state, it's not fatal. So he's only going to do that every second time for just technical reasons about, you know, how fast he can do things and the precision of these rotations. So it's a two-part thing where you, if there's a jump, you fix it. If there's no jump, you let it go. You measure the parity again. If there's a jump, you fix it with something that both fixes that jump and fixes the e to the you know, the constant damping term that's happening all the time. If there's no jump there, you fix it with a slightly different unitary. Come back here, and then you repeat 1 to 19 times. And then you can do, there are these so-called process tomography to describe how well the recovery map is working. Yes, the second step is better, but this this no jump recovery is not perfect, you know, and so doing it because it's imperfect, you don't want to do it too often. Also, I didn't quite understand, but there were some technical limitations in the feed forward, you know, the speed with which he could do things. So they did it that way. Yeah.
So there's also this question of whether when you detect an error, do you really correct for it, or do you just do a polygram update by memorizing what the error was and then redefining all your frames, which allows you to just keep track of the errors.
Yeah.
And
right. So some codes let you do that. The cat code that Maziar will talk about lets you do that. Here, if you actually lose a photon, you have to fix it.
And can you say at which stage, so one thing that I'm not certain about, at which stage actually correcting these errors then is strictly required?
So,
when you start to do the gates or
No, this is just a memory operation.
Yeah.
And you have, every time the parity jumps, you must fix it, because more generally. So then it just depends on the details of the code and the error model. Sometimes you can say, I'm still in the code space. I just, my frame got rotated. And if I keep track of that in software, it's fine. If your next gate is a Clifford gate, you can still keep track of it in software. But if it's not a Clifford gate, then you have to put it back in the right frame before you do that. Otherwise, because Clifford gate circuits can be simulated efficiently classically, you can keep track in software, but if you're doing something universal, it's exponentially hard to keep track, so you have to rotate back to the original frame. Does that make sense? Yeah.
Right, but maybe for the binomial code, the larger ones, I remember also in our paper we discussed this, that if some errors happen, you're really in a code space that corrects fewer errors. Right? And that's different from stabilizer code. If you have a poly error happen, you're in another equally good code space.
Right. So
and some of the binomial, but it depends on what error also.
Yeah, right.
And
so. Yeah, so in this code, the simplest, the baby code, it only corrects one loss. There are more complicated codes where you go to another space, which is also an error correction code, but it can only it can tolerate one more loss, or, you know, you altogether you can tolerate three losses or something. And so you don't have to correct till you get to the edge. Then you do have to correct. Okay, so let's see. This comes close to the Maziar will tell you about the cat code, which actually slightly beats break even. This one comes very close, essentially almost breaks even, but not quite. So let's again remind ourselves about these. So here's some process fidelity. The process we're trying to achieve is the identity, because this is memory. I want to put it in the memory, go away, come back, and pull it out and get the same state. So the process should be the identity. If I put the state into the transmon, it decays in 38 microseconds. if I encode the state in the photons using the binomial code in the cavity, it decays in 71 microseconds. I'm not doing any error correction. I'm just putting it into the cavity and leaving it there. The cavity has a longer lifetime than the transmon, but it also has, on average, two photons in it. So this is still decaying in 71 microseconds. If I turn on the error correction, and I do that every 18 microseconds, which is not, I could do it faster, but each error correction is imperfect. And remember, I showed you in the first lecture in classical fault tolerance, you want to adjust the timing so that the errors you're making and the errors the memory you're making are about the same rate, same probability. So that's this time, fairly long, leisurely waiting time for the FPGA. And then, so that's the green one. It rises up to 200 microseconds, so a huge gain relative to not doing the error correction. But the thing to beat is the FOC01 encoding, which decays, you know, with the, has the least number of photons, so decays with the cavity decay rate. And you can see it comes very close, but doesn't quite beat that. But close to break even. Well, so I'm doing all kinds of stuff trying to extend the lifetime. I've got a fancy encoding and blah, blah, blah. And I don't have to do any of that if I just use the 0-1 encoding. And but the 0-1 encoding, I get 216 microseconds of lifetime. Of the cavity. Yeah.
And then you determine to do the logical 0 to logical 1 with this binomial code.
So I have to use the transmon to do, to make FOX states and do rotations between 0 and 1. But as a memory, it lasts 216 microseconds. If I can't beat that, I shouldn't bother doing all the error correcting coding. So that's what I mean by break even. And the reason this is 70, this has on average half a photon, this has on average two photons. It's worse, but before I turn on the error correction. When I turn on the error correction, I almost get back to where I started, but not quite. So I haven't quite, I'm in, you know, sort of 90, 95% of break even, but not quite there. I want to be 10 or 100 times break even. Nobody's there yet. But but if you try this with qubits, it's you're.
It's quite impressive.
Yeah.
So is this related that you only correct the no jump error every second time, or?
So there are a number of things you could do better. I'll show you what it will take to break even with parameters improved in a moment, I think. There's a number of, you know, the operations aren't perfect. I'm not. It's very, very hard to do quantum error correction.
The difference, is light difference, is it the transmon or is power control?
For why it doesn't reach break-even? I'll show you some parameters in a second.
Break-even is just defined in terms of the coherence time?
Like yeah. For this is break-even for memory, for the memory operation.
Okay.
And again, if you had, you know, the Shor code, you would have 9 physical qubits. The error rate jumps up by a factor of 9. You have to do all kinds of stuff to recover that factor of 9. And if you don't beat, among those 9 qubits, one of them is the best. That's the one you have to beat.
So then you could redo this for all of the other kinds of channels as opposed to just memory?
Yes, and I'll show you. Yeah, you should also do this for gate operations, right? And it's hard. That's also hard. Okay, so here's a kind of gate error correction gate. This is a logical yes.
So you said it can have cavities every 3 minutes, and now it seems to be only on the order of 100 microseconds.
So this is 200 microseconds. So it's true that there's an inverse Purcell effect, that when you stick your crappy transmon into the cavity, the instead of having the transmon decay into the cavity can decay into the transmon. There's a little bit of that. I don't actually remember. What's that? Yeah, yeah, I mean it. Yeah, I don't know what's down, you know, there's a bunch of things. The transmon, may not be, I don't remember whether it's 6063 aluminum or pure aluminum or what. Yeah, I should know that, but I don't. Okay, so this is a logical Ramsey fringe experiment. You do a logical pi over 2, you wait, you do another logical pi over 2, and you look for dephasing. And it's done in a way where you're almost, you're in a frame where the qubit is barely rotating, so you know, it would look better if it if there were lots of wiggles, but so this is the logical T2 without error correction and with error correction. And again, 213 microseconds is pretty close to what you can do with single photon. Yep.
So in the experiment without error correction, you basically wait for the time that the error correction is possible, right?
Well, you wait whatever. Different amounts of time, yeah.
But why you don't wait for quantum error correction phase?
So there are discrete points here where you have waited a certain length of time, then you apply you're doing error. So these are probably integer multiples of that 18 microsecond time, probably.
I think it's confused, but the soft block where it says QEC, where you mean QEC and wait. So correcting while waiting.
Yeah. This is correcting while waiting. I mean, you're correcting until the time you decide, you do this multiple times. And then at some moment you stop and you do the next pi over 2 pulse and you measure. Does that make sense? So once you do the pi over 2 rotation, it's like a memory operation. You're just waiting for the dephasing to happen and you're trying to, yeah. Yeah. You wouldn't have to do anything.
Yes.
Rotation. Sorry. Rotations of. Okay. So I have to do a logical pi over 2, which is much more complicated than just adding half a photon. I have to, right? And then during that time, now it's just like a memory. I'm just sitting there. So now I'm applying the quantum error correction protocol. Boom, 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 every 18 microseconds. And then when I've decided it's time to end the Ramsey sequence, I apply the 90-degree pulse and measure. Well, you know, the Ramsey it has, it's, you have some clock, which is some frame, you know, it's a frame dependent thing. It's the phase of the second 90 degree pulse. You know, if your local oscillator exactly matches the cavity, there would be no wiggles at all, but it would still indicate coherence. If you were detuned, it would be wiggling rapidly. So I could have made it look spectacular with lots of wiggles if I had chosen a different frame. But yeah.
Sorry, I'm still confused, but you're reading out on the qubit population, but really that y-axis codes for the logical 0 to 1 state?
No, I'm reading out the logical state.
Okay, that's logical ground state population.
Yeah, yeah. This is the, yes. Yeah. Now, the way you read that out is through some fancy pulse sequence that maps the logical photon state on back onto the ancilla state, which you read out with the other resonator. Yeah, so.
But that's logical.
That's logical ground and excited. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, why the contrast is dying?
Yeah, the reason is that you leave your cosmic space, or you just get superposition of your
cosmos. Good. Okay, good question. So, if I had a really two-level qubit, and no higher levels, I can't leave the code space, but the phase of the superposition, I lose control of that. That all I have is dephasing. Here. You know, I could get two photon losses by accident and leave the code space. I could add a photon and move out of the code space in another direction. It's some combination of those, and I don't, I'm not calibrated on exactly what's the dominant thing. That's a good question. Okay. Why is this not advancing? Okay. So there's, they did some modeling to try to understand the error budget, and so one thing is that there's the time interval, the waiting time between rounds of quantum error correction, because the operations aren't perfect, you don't want to do them too often. So if your operation to recover has a fidelity of 95%, this is what the decay time would look like. If you have a recovery of 100%, it would look like this, and the experiment is sitting about there, 97% or something. The transmon, again, is the weak link. You have to have it for the control, but it has a shorter coherence time than the cavity. It was, T1 was 38 microseconds or something. And this is the phase coherence time of the, of the ancilla. You have to, it's dominated by the T1, basically. You have to move from here to maybe double the T1 time of the transmon to get that last few percent to reach the break-even point, going from 200 microseconds of memory time to 216. So, this is hard. But there are many things could be improved, but basically the fidelity with which, if you make a mistake in measuring the error syndrome and you think there's a jump when there wasn't, you're going to apply a correction, which is you are going to make the mistake instead of the system. It's just very, very hard. It has to be really precise operations in order to reach break even. Okay? Yeah.
Right. Like, it's not productive.
You might think, oh, I could. It'd be so much easier if I just made the cavity lifetime twice as long. Actually, it's harder.
Yeah, exactly.
Because your target gets better. That's right. And in the, there's a vast literature, experimental literature on quantum error correction, and everybody, nobody ever like advertises that they didn't reach break even.
I mean, that might be why they're not using a microsecond cavity.
Yeah. Right. So what was done, it's typically done in an error correction experiment, is you introduce artificial errors. You add noise to rotate the qubit, and you say, oh, look, I can fix that. But to break even, you have to fix the naturally occurring errors. And that's much, much harder. Yeah. Yeah. Let's see. At one point, I could have. Let's see. So there's a big error budget. The T1 of the transmon, the T5 of the transmon, the kappa of the cavity. There's the precision of your rotations of the transmon. Feeds into precision of rotations around the logical block sphere. There's your ability to measure the parity. So there are many things contributing. This is one thing you could fix to get slightly better. The whole error budget calculation requires a very complicated modeling of the entire process, and you see which thing will give me the most benefit. But maybe Chris has some more intelligent remark here.
This F recovery?
Yeah. Maybe that's not including the. I think that's just the unitary to recover and not the parity measurement for them. That's right. That's right. That's right. That's right. So the thing that's definitely not fault tolerant here is the parity measurement, because you're putting the ancilla in a pi over 2 state and letting it rotate around depending on how many photons are in the cavity. So if there's a 0, you stay here. If there's 1, you go here, 2, 3, 4. And you, as it winds around, you forget how many times it went around. Just count whether it went around an even or an odd number of times. That's how the parity measurement works. But if it falls down in the middle, there's a huge back action on the cavity and the state is destroyed. It's a very non-fault tolerant parity measurement. So that's in the CAT codes. That was the one of the several, but one very important limiting factor.
I have one question. Maybe you mentioned it. So there, the uncorrected binomial code. So you could be saying, I prepare the code word and I just let it sit there.
Yeah.
I don't do any measurements. Or you could say, another scheme is I do the measurements, but I'm not actually looking at them. I'm not using them to finally infer. And that is sort of a Zeno, there's an effect before you do error correction, which is sort of, I'm forcing errors not to happen by keeping saying.
Yeah, yeah.
And that could also be have a beneficial effect. So the
right.
So the question is, the uncorrected binomial code here is the.
You put it in, you do nothing.
You redo nothing.
Yeah.
You don't just measure anything.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right. That's right. Other questions? Yeah. No, sadly, it's always connected. So one problem is just when it's idling, which it is often because you don't do, it can accidentally jump up because of quasiparticles or something heating it up. And then there's a big frequency shift of the cavity from the dispersor shift, and the cavity dephases. So I advertise that these aluminum cavities have very little dephasing, only a little bit of amplitude damping. But that's not true when the ancilla is coupled to it. If the ancilla accidentally changes state, then there's a bad dephasing event. So that's another thing that limits the, limits the CAT code experiments. And there's a workaround for that to make it fault tolerant, which I have as an extra slide.
Sorry, where is this number around 18 microseconds coming from? So if you go back to this regional function representation, this means like
That's right. That time was optimized because the recovery operation is not perfect. So this is the time for those two rounds, 18 microseconds. The first one you don't fix the no jump, the second one you do. So that's the 36 microseconds there. That time was optimized. We could go much faster, but because the recovery is not perfect, if you go faster, you'll be the cause of most of the errors. If you wait longer, the memory is the cause of most of the errors.
Epsilon M and epsilon
M. Exactly. The thing in my first lecture, epsilon and epsilon M. Exactly. Yeah? Good. More questions. That's fine. Go ahead.
Maybe a potential criticism.
Sure. Yes, so T2 errors will cause you to deduce the wrong parity, which could cause you to correct something that's not there, thereby making an error. But I don't think it causes back action, whereas T1 on the ancilla causes a disaster in the cavity because of the dispersive coupling. Right, that T1 does more than one thing. Yeah. Okay. Why is this stopped? There we go. So I thought I had briefly mentioned the 4-qubit amplitude damping code. I thought it'd be kind of cool to compare head to head two codes. Both designed for amplitude damping, okay? And this is the Debbie Lung Ike Chuang 1997 4-qubit code for amplitude damping. Remember, you need 5 qubits to fix one single general error, but for amplitude damping, you can do 4 qubits to first order in DT, approximate error correction. And there's some cool analogies with the bosonic code. So here's all qubits down, all qubits up. Here's 0 photons and 4 photons. So 0 excitations, 4 excitations. 0 photons, 4 photons. The other code word is 1100 plus 0011. It has 2 excitations. It happens to be a superposition. This has 2 excitations, 2 photons. The average excitation number is 2. For both code words in both codes. But this has a Hilbert space dimension of 2^4, 16 states. Here, I'm gonna have count the code words only use 3 states, and there's some error words, so altogether there's only 5. The big difference comes in the total number of errors. You can have no error, or you can have an error on each of the 4 qubits. That's 5 error states. In the bosonic code, amplitude damping, you either didn't lose a photon or you did, but there's only one mode that's losing the photon. So there's only 2 errors. Huge advantage, okay? You can find some stabilizers. These are both eigenstates of these joint parities. Z1, Z2 is always even. Z3, Z4 is always even. Here, photon number parity is always even. So there are 2 stabilizers in this code, 1 stabilizer in this code. But is this a stabilizer code? No, because there are 5 possible errors, and the stabilizers can only represent 2^2, 4 states. So you can't just measure the stabilizers and figure out what error happened. you have to project, you know, do this thing I showed you in general for the recovery operation, which is project onto the different measure which error subspace you're in. Whereas this actually is a stabilizer code, you only have two kinds of errors, and the one stabilizer you have tells you which one happened. So another big advantage, okay? And then they both do approximate error correction to first order in the damping rate. So you can see the huge efficiency you gain. You don't want to represent too many qubits in one cavity because it takes exponentially many levels. But there's a huge gain to representing a small number, replacing a small number of qubits by the bigger Hilbert space of a single mode in the cavity, because there are fewer errors. Even though they're both amplitude damping, there are fewer errors. You don't have to figure out where in geography, where in space the qubit error happened. It's all happening in the one mode in the bosonic cavity. So that's why this comes close to break even, and this is much harder. Yeah. Of course.
What about doing two-qubit gate, logical two-qubit gates, and interaction using bosonic codes?
I'm glad you mentioned that. Yeah. So there's several experiments. I'm not going to show you like the first one that was done, but this is a kind of cool one that's done by teleportation and deterministic teleportation. Yeah. Yes, please.
One more remark about perfectly code. Is also an error detection code that detects one error, and it has been implemented on the five superconducting qubits, actually, with almost break even for some tests.
Right. That was for state preparation, I think, right? Yeah.
So that code allows some transversal gates, some full power gates.
Yeah.
And you can test, like, if I do these gates, in this full power manner, do I get better data than if I do them on a bare transport gate?
Yes.
And that is, well, it's hard to draw conclusions.
Yeah.
But there's several papers on this.
That's true. That's right. That's true. Yeah. That's good. I don't know why I'm not, why is, okay. All right, so the idea, you have some modules and maybe there's a high Q memory qubit that's got some bosonic code for error correction. Maybe there's some kind of communication qubit that's optimized for generating remote entanglement, which is your resource. And once you have that, possibly these are good at communicating, but maybe they don't make the best Bell pairs, but maybe you can distill them. I haven't done that yet, but maybe you end up with a resource. If you have an entangled pair, then you can do local operations and local measurements and feed forward with classical communication to remotely entangle the memory qubits. Okay, and this has been done in various technologies, typically not, I think, deterministically. So you start with the entangled pair, you do local C-naughts, you do local measurements, you feed forward with classical communication of those measurement results, and you can end up teleporting a particular, a gate, like the C-naught. And so here's the two remote modules, a centimeter apart. And the data qubits are these post cavities, and the communication qubit is a transmon in a 3D cavity, and this fancy control electronics, and there's a bus cavity through which you communicate with the communication qubits. So we're going to take the binomial code, and we're going to do a teleported control NOT gate at the logical level. Okay, so here's the two remote qubits in various states: zero logical. These are the Wigner functions, of course: 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. And we're going to do a teleported logical C naught. And so here's the output. So you see that, let's see, which A is the control, B is the target. And you can see that when A is in 1, the target flips from 0 logical to 1 logical and from 1 logical to 0 logical. But when the control is in 0, nothing happens except a tiny frame shift from some, which is deterministic and you can take into account in software. So that's data. So you can see in pictures that it seems to be working. And the pictures look to me like that has higher than 79% fidelity, but when you really measure the process tomography, it's only about 79%. So there's still work to do, but you know.
What is the actual shift implementation?
What is the what?
The actual implementation. Where are you doing these quantum error correction cycles?
Ah, so these are error correctable code words, but no error correction has been done in this process. Okay, so you got to take baby steps. First, you do logical C naughts on things that could be error corrected but aren't, and then you try to do error correction just before the gate and just after. That we haven't done yet. That's the hope. Yeah. Right. Well, you know, this is the next step. Yeah. But you're right. I mean, there's a lot, you know, we need a lot of nines here if we're going to, you know, actually do this. And we're not there yet. Okay, so I've got a few minutes left. I've been showing you a whole bunch of operations, you know, single cube logical qubit rotations. Two logical qubit C naught, but all of these are specific pulse sequences that work for a particular code. What if we could create universal gates that work for any code? The 0-1 code, the binomial code, the CAT code, one of the fancier binomial codes. What if they were completely code agnostic? That would be kind of cool. And so you could like build your hardware, and you could be using some, you know, software, you know, 1.0. You have 0-1 encoding, and then you do a software upgrade where you use a better code, and none of the hardware has to change. That would be kind of cool. Okay, so and you could also use different codes in different parts of the computer, also for fault tolerance, where you have to do code switching, you might be able to do that. Okay, so I'm going to show you all the data. I'm going to show you is from Yvonne Gao and Brian Lester and company and Rob Scroop in these two papers, and I'm going to show you three things: a swap gate, which just, you know, is a beam splitter. A Fredkin gate, which is a three-mode controlled swap. You swap if and only if some ancilla is in a certain state. It doesn't work that well. But then something that seems crazy and harder is actually easier, the exponential swap gate. And this is going to be a code-independent universal entangling gate. Okay, so we'll start with swap. So we have a Josephson frequency converter. It's just a four-wave mixer, a transmon with some low inharmonicity. There are two pump tones, and their frequency difference compensates for the frequency difference of the two cavities and lets you make a frequency-converting beam splitter, as if the cavities were degenerate and just had some linear, bilinear coupling between them. And because it relies on the pumps, you can choose the amplitude and phase and the time dependence of this coupling any way you want. Okay, so here's two cavities, Alice and Bob. Alice is sitting in the vacuum. There's the vacuum noise in the phase space plot. Real part of beta is position, imaginary part is momentum. Here's Bob sitting in one of the binomial code states. And we're gonna make turn on the beam splitter and kind of make a Mach-Zehnder interferometer, but in time. This is time. It's not actual spatial paths that are different. There's just two cavities. I turn on the beam splitter between them for a little while. I wait. I turn it on again. So there's a 50-50 beam splitter, and then I wait, and another 50-50 beam splitter. And depending on the phase you choose here, you can make this guy come out that port or come out the other port. So, and do a swap. So, as you can see, after the two 50-50 beam splitters, Alice and Bob have swapped states. Okay? And it's a linear optics operation. It doesn't care what's in the cavities. It could be vacuum and vacuum, zero and one, two different cat codes. It's just linear optics. It just takes whatever's here and whatever's there and swaps them. So it's code independent. Okay? It's also kind of trivial. It's not an entangling gate. But it's a start. Okay. So now suppose I make my Mach-Zehnder interferometer and I have a conditional phase gate to an ancilla that might or might not have inserted a pi phase shift in the state, you know, a parity operation in one of the two cavities. Then I can change the phase, the interference in the interferometer and swap into not swap, but a superposition, because this guy might be in a superposition state. So basically, controlled swap is if the ancilla is in the excited state, carry out a swap in the two cavities. If it's in the ground state, don't swap them. And there's these process tomography matrices where Alice and Bob have zero and one photons, and the ancilla is in the superposition of both ground and excited. Which produces this state. So the part that's ground, there was no swap, and the part that's excited, there was a swap. And then there's in the minus state, I guess this is ideal. Afterwards, and these are the experiments. You can see some little faint errors there. The overall fidelity over all three modes, the two cavities and the transmon ancilla, is pretty low. It's only 65%. It's dominated by the crappy ancilla. It's hard to do this in a fault-tolerant way when you can't live without that ancilla. So it doesn't work all that well. But something that seems more complicated actually works better, and that's exponential swap. So this is there's an amazing paper by Lau and Plenio who proposed using eSwap, exponential swap, as a powerful resource to build universal computation for bosonic modes. So here's the first experiment to make that work. The idea is swap is not entangling, but what if I could do a superposition of swap and identity? And because swap is idempotent, it's just like if you put a sigma x there, you would get this familiar formula. It also works for swap, because swap squared is identity. So if I could do exponential swap, and I had a controllable theta, I could do a superposition of nothing and swapping. And that's clearly entangling. In particular, for theta is pi over 2, I would get swap. For theta is 0, I would get identity. For theta is pi over 4, I would get square root of I swap, which, started with spin qubits and exchange. That's a favorite entangling gate. So, and the cool thing is, it uses the identity, which works for any code, and it uses swap, which works for any code. Okay? So it doesn't matter what's in the cavities, you can entangle them with any encoding. And as Lau and Plenio showed, you can make universal gate sets. It also is a handy thing for quantum principle component analysis and quantum machine learning. If you want something really, really speculative and hard to do, think about that for a while. But it's a quite powerful thing. Okay, so here it is. Here's the circuit. So there's Alice and Bob and some Wyman for joint parity measurements and some other ancillary. And so Alice and Bob are in some density matrices. There's a 50-50 beam splitter, which is the slowest operation we have. And this can be made much better as we learn how to use three-wave mixers or other things to improve the rate at which we can do this. So you leave the ancilla in the ground state during that time. Then you put it in a superposition. You point it in the x direction. You do the controlled parity operation. You do a rotation around the x-axis by an angle theta that's going to define this. You do another controlled parity operation. You put the ancilla back in the ground state. And then you do an inverse beam splitter with the, just change the phase of the four-wave mixer. So if this rotation angle is 0, you'll either get identity twice or pi phase shift twice. These will cancel. The two beam splitters will cancel. You'll get the identity. As you rotate this, you don't get perfect cancellation, and you end up getting some net swap. Okay? That's roughly, you've got to sit down and work through all of it, but that's roughly how it goes. And it works better than the controlled swap because you don't have to put the ancilla into the excited state until after that, just for a very short length of time. Okay, so so here is square root of I swap, where Alice has coherent state alpha and Bob has coherent state minus alpha. And so you end up with a parity-less cat because of that I. It's not plus or minus. These have indefinite parity, so you couldn't possibly end up in a cat with definite parity. It has to be an I there because that's why it's square root of I swap. But you deterministically entangle the two cavities. And so here's a simulation of, so I have two cavities. Each has a position and a momentum. So phase space is four-dimensional. So I have to make a four-dimensional Wigner function. It's hard to plot. So I'm so here's momentum of Alice, momentum of Bob. It's a two-dimensional slice in the four-dimensional space, and you see it's all, it's like all fringes. Here is position Alice, position Bob. So what does that say? If Alice has a positive position, Bob has a negative position, and vice versa. Well, that's exactly the state, right? And here's the data. And you see some little bit of some coherences that are not supposed to be there. If you add to the model calculation a little bit of self-cur inherited from the all those ancillary, it matches. So you can kind of quantify that entanglement by pretending that it's two qubits. So like alpha is qubit state 0 and minus alpha is qubit state 1. If you project all the states you have onto those two bases, then this entangled state is like that Bell state. And you can make these Pauli bar plots that you make for Bell states and see how close you come. Here's the ideal, and here's the, you know, you don't quite get there, and some things that are supposed to be zero aren't quite zero. But you can kind of define a Bell state basis that way. The overlap to the ideal entangled state is 74%, not as particularly great. It turns out the way this particular one was set up to do good job on the entangling, it did a less good job on the state preparation and measurement. So most of this is spam errors, a little bit from Kerr, a little bit from cavity relaxation and dephasing and non-idealities in the beam splitters and so forth. Okay. So then you can do, I'm over time. All right, I won't show you, I'll stop. There's all kinds of, crazy process tomography for square root of I swap, and I'll just skip over that. And so I showed you this kind of big picture is, can we build a bosonic-based information processors? Some very important gates that will help us do that. And there's lots of room for improving these operations that do the beam splitters and the controlled swaps. Mm-hmm. And so this is a kind of combine some of the best features of linear optics, like beam splitters and swaps and swaps don't care what code you're using, but it has actual entangling gates that you can do, makes it exponentially more efficient than simplest versions of linear optics quantum computing. So still a long, long way to go, but we're slowly building, two-cylinder cars and Cinquecentos and four-cylinder cars. So hopefully there'll be progress, and I thank you for listening. Paul. I didn't notice the time. Sorry, I ran over. More questions? Yeah.
What is the scalability of this setup? Like, you're talking here about one cavity, one transmon, and then you have to start putting, 10 cavities, 10 transmons.
Yeah.
It's not as obvious using superconducting circuits.
So it's going to be hard, but there's great isolation doing it this way. When you have a 2D architecture and you send some pulses here, lots of the neighbors know about it. It's the on-off ratios and the isolation here are a big advantage. The physical size, some people say, the cavities are so big, but as Rob Sholkoff says, you can buy a fridge with a cubic meter of cold space, and in a cubic meter, there's a million cubic centimeters. So it would be a quality problem to run out of room. It's going to be hard, but this might be less hard than other ways. We don't know yet. Okay, time for coffee. Thank you.